First things first, I'd like to thank Andrew Monacos as a patron of Arts and Ideas. Yeah. When Anne met with our programming team to first talk about possibilities for her first named lecture here at the JCC, we came up with many ideas, but as soon as she heard about the complete works, that was it. She was set. So thanks to her generosity, we were able to assemble truly an all-star lineup of guests whose bios you can read in your handout program, but I'm so excited to be here tonight, and I hope you are too. This is really a wonderful, wonderful program lineup. Here this evening to get the program off the ground is Mauro Battocchi, the Consul General to Italy in San Francisco. Mauro.
So, dear Stephanie, ladies and gentlemen, it is a real privilege for me to attend this event on Primo Levi. My heartfelt thanks to JCC for taking the initiative. It honors me to see Levi recognized today in San Francisco by so many distinguished speakers, because I venture to say that by now, Primo Levi has become one of the most respected and beloved writers in Italian literature. I have to say that his words marked my intellectual and emotional coming of age, mine, but as well as that of so many young Italians starting from the 60s. His words resonate in my mind indelibly. You who live safe in your warm houses, you who find returning in the evening hot food and friendly faces, consider if this is a man, se questo è un uomo, who works in the mud, who does not know peace, who fights for a scrap of bread, who dies because of a yes or a no. And yet, when Levi went back from Auschwitz to Torino and presented his manuscript of This is a Man to the Einaudi publisher, he was turned down. It took several years before his message broke through a wall of rejection and disbelief, or simply discomfort. The first years after his return back home, he had a hard time to make himself heard. Yes, it was disbelief and discomfort, for it was very hard for Italians to come to terms with the sheer tragedy of what Italy's fascist regime had contributed creating. At the end of September, here in San Francisco, we had a great event at the Castro Theater with a movie directed by Vittorio De Sica, The Garden of the Finzi Continis, after a novel by Giorgio Bassani. The movie shows the story of a Jewish-Italian family until the moment of their deportation. And if you saw the movie, I mean, you can remember, they leave their beautiful mansion in Ferrara in disbelief. They can't believe what their compatriots are doing to them, forcing them out of their homes. Primo Levi takes a step further and shows the next step of the victims of deportation into horror and hell. So I believe that today, Italians are very thankful to Levi for giving us his accurate, detailed, neutral report of the path of degradation that he had to go through. He reminds us that at every time, every nation, including our own, has to be vigilant. Our respect for other human beings cannot be taken for granted, unfortunately, especially if we label those human beings with dehumanizing tags. And we have, as you know, many of them. So let me say thanks, grazie, to JCC, and I would say grazie to Primo Levi for his extraordinary testimony. Enjoy the program. Grazie.
Thank you. I'm going to read two poems. One of them is by Primo Levi. One is by Constantine Cavafy, the modern Greek poet. And the reason I'm doing this is because when I found the poem that I'll be reading of Primo Levi's called A Profession, I couldn't stop thinking of a poem called The First Step by Cavafy. And they speak to each other. And I've been thinking, even just out in the green room, as to whether I should read them both. But I'm going to, because they're one somehow for me. All right. And this one is called The First Step. And it was written sometime early last century in Alexandria. All right. The young poet Evmenis complained one day to Theocritos. I've been writing for 2 years now, and I have composed just one idyll. It's my only completed work. I see, sadly, that the ladder of poetry is tall, extremely tall. And from this first step I now stand on, I will never climb any higher. Theocritos replied, words like that are improper, blasphemous. Just to be on the first step should make you happy and proud. To have come this far is no small achievement. What you have done is a glorious thing. Even this first step is a long way above the ordinary world. To stand on this step, you must be in your own right a member of the city of ideas. And it is a hard, unusual thing to be enrolled as a citizen of that city. Its councils are full of legislators no charlatan can fool. To have come this far is no small achievement. What you have done already is a glorious thing. And this was written or published January 2nd, 1984. A profession. All you have to do is wait, your ballpoint poised. The lines will buzz around you like drunk moths. One comes near the flame, you grab it. No, it's not over, one is not enough. But it's a lot already, the work started. The others compete to land nearby, lined up or in a circle, ordered or disordered. Simple and silent, obedient to your command. You are the boss, without a doubt. If it's a good day, you order them in droves. Fine work, no? It's time-honored, 60 centuries old and ever new, with strict rules or relaxed ones or no rules, as you like. You sense you're in good company, not lazy, not lost, not always useless, sandaled and togaed, cloaked in linen, crowned with laurel. Just be careful that you don't presume. Thank you.
Two more poems. Primo Levi wrote poems throughout his life. These are early poems in which he tries to get at that experience, the experience that he calls of those ferocious nights. So these poems, I picked two of them from a gorgeous book, the Forrest Strauss anthology of 20th century Italian poetry. It's the place where Primo Levi's great prose writer takes his place among the astonishing Italian poets who survived that destructive wreckage of the 40s, Senzotto and Montali and Campagna, Saba. The first poem has, I picked these two because one of them just tries to get, must be just trying to re-experience what it was like to be there. And the second one is one in which he wrestles with the meaning. And Goldstein, maybe should read the first one. I should say a word about the first poem. It has a Polish word in it. And the word is wstać, and it means get up. But in Polish, it would pronounce slightly differently. It would have a religious context of arise, a resurrection.
Alzarsi. Sognavamo nelle notti feroci, sogni densi e violenti, sognati con anima e corpo, tornare, mangiare, raccontare, finché suonava breve sommesso il comando dell'alba, stach. E si spezzava in petto il cuore. Ora abbiamo ritrovato la casa, il nostro ventre è sazio. Abbiamo finito di raccontare, è tempo. Presto udremo ancora il comando straniero. Vistach.
Italian language is so beautiful. Everything sounds amazing in it. So it's reveille in English. In the brutal nights, we dream dense, violent dreams, dreamed with soul and body, to return, to eat, to tell the story, until the dawn command sounded brief and low, Vistach. And the heart cracked in the breast. Now we have found our homes again. Our bellies are full. We've finished telling the story. It's time. Soon we'll hear again that strange command, Vistach. The second poem, and in Italian, Scema.
Scema. Voi che vivete sicuri nelle vostre tiepide case, voi che trovate tornando a sera il cibo caldo e visi amici, considerate se questo è un uomo che lavora nel fango, che non conosce pace, che lotta per mezzo pane, che muore per un sì o per un no. Considerate se questa è una donna, senza capelli, senza nome, senza più forza di ricordare, vuoti gli occhi e freddo il grembo, come una rana d'inverno. Meditate che questo è stato. Vi comando queste parole. Scolpitele nel vostro cuore, stando in casa, andando per via, coricandovi, alzandovi. Ripetetele ai vostri figli. O vi si sfaccia la casa, la malattia vi impedisca. I vostri nati torcano il viso da voi.
The thing I love about poetry is that 60, 70 years after that poem was written, you're hearing his voice, his breath, his vowels, his breathing. Shema. You who live safe in your warm houses, you who come home at evening to find hot food and friendly faces, consider if this is a man who toils in the mud, who knows no peace, who fights for a chunk of bread, who dies at a yes or a no. Consider if this is a woman without hair and without name, without strength to remember, empty eyes and cold womb like a frog in winter. Be mindful that this has been. I urge these words on you. Carve them on your heart. At home or roaming the streets, lying down or rising up, repeat them to your children, or may your houses fall. Sickness lay you low. Your offspring turned their faces from your eyes. Primo Levi.
I want to read a short prose portrait of Henri, a young man who appears in, if this is a man, Primo Levi's masterwork about the evil at the camps, the destruction of the best, the destruction even of those who thought they survived. I've edited these paragraphs to fit into this small space of time. Henri. Henri is eminently civilized and sane and possesses a complete and organic theory on ways to survive in the lager. He's only 22. He's extremely intelligent, speaks French, German, English, and Russian, has an excellent scientific and classical education. His brother died in Buna last winter, and from that day, Henri cut off every tie of affection. He closed himself up in himself as if in armor and fights to live without destruction, using all the resources that he can derive from his quick intellect and his refined upbringing. According to Henri's theory, there are three methods by means of which a man can escape extermination and still remain worthy of the name man. Organization, compassion, and theft. He practices all three. There is no better strategist than Henri in manipulating, cultivating, he says, the English prisoners of war. In his hands, they become real geese with golden eggs. If you remember that in exchange for a single English cigarette, you can get enough in the lager not to starve for a day. Henri was once seen in the act of eating a real hard-boiled egg. Trading in products of English origin is Henri's monopoly, and this is all a matter of organization. But his instrument of penetration with the English and with others is compassion. Henri has the delicate and subtly androgynous body and face of Sodoma's Saint Sebastian. His eyes are dark and profound. He has no beard yet. He moves with a natural, languid elegance, although when necessary, he can run and jump like a cat. Henri is perfectly aware of his natural gifts and exploits them with the cool competence of someone handling a scientific instrument. The results are surprising. Basically, it's a question of discovery. Henri has discovered that compassion, being a primary and instinctive sentiment, flourishes if skillfully inculcated, particularly in the primitive minds of the brutes who command us. Those very brutes who have no scruples about knocking us down for no reason and trampling us once we're on the ground. Nor has the great practical importance of the discovery escaped him. And on it, he has built up his personal industry. Henri sizes up the subject, son type, at a glance. He speaks to him briefly in the appropriate language, and the type is conquered. He listens with increasing sympathy. He is moved by the fate of this unfortunate young man, and it isn't long before he begins to yield results. There is no heart so hardened that Henri cannot breach it if he sets himself to it seriously. In the lager and in Buna as well, his protectors are extremely numerous. English soldiers, French, Ukrainian, Polish civilian workers, German politicals, a cook, even an SS officer. It's natural that Henri, possessing such notable friendships, is rarely reduced to the third method, theft. On the other hand, of course, it's not a subject that he willingly discusses. It's very pleasant to talk to Henri in moments of rest. It's also useful. There is nothing in the camp that he does not know and about which he has not reasoned in his close, coherent manner. Of his conquests, he speaks with polite modesty. And as a prey of little value, but he digresses willingly to explain the calculation that led him to approach Hans by asking him about his son at the front, or Otto by showing him the scars on his shins. To speak with Henri is useful and pleasant. Sometimes one feels a warmth and closeness, communication. Even affection seems possible. One seems to glimpse the sorrowful, conscious, human depth of his uncommon personality. But the next moment, his sad smile freezes into a cold grimace that appears practiced at the mirror. Henri politely excuses himself. J'ai quelque chose à faire. J'ai quelqu'un à voir. And here he is again, intent on his hunt and his struggle, hard and distant, enclosed in armor, the enemy of all, inhumanly sly and incomprehensible, like the serpent in Genesis. After my talks with Henri, even the most cordial, I always had a slight taste of defeat and a confused suspicion of having been, in some inadvertent way, not a man to him, but an instrument in his hands. I know that Henri is alive. I would give much to know his life as a free man. But I do not want to see him again.
Hope you can hear us. Yes, wonderful. My name is Francesco Spagnolo. It's really my honor to moderate tonight's panel. We have some time to talk about the works of Primo Levi and their translation into English. And I brought to our panelists a little present. It's not very precious. It's a printout from, you know, from the internet. But you have it too. If you were able to grab one. It's a list. And it's a list that the great Italian writer Italo Calvino, whose collected works have yet to appear in English, correct? Yes. Correct. Wrote, and they're part of the plot around his six memos for the next millennium, which he prepared. These were lectures, these were Norton lectures that he was invited to present at Harvard in 1985. He didn't complete them, and he died that same year. But if you go through the list, you'll see that the list includes lightness, quickness, exactitude, visibility, multiplicity, and consistency. He wrote this in English. He prepared the lectures in English, so we don't need to translate these into Italian for the time being. When I thought about speaking with you tonight, these six categories or literary values immediately came to mind because it is my feeling that they can all be applied to Primo Levi. And that's not true of every writer, right? I'm sure we can think of many writers to whom at least some, if not all of these categories don't really apply. And echoing also the opening words of the Consul General of Italy, Mauro Battocchi, about the fact that Primo Levi has really inspired a whole generation of Italians since the 60s, you know, I remember growing up, I remember exactly where Se questo un uomo, if this is a man, the single volume in the Einaudi edition was in the library, was among the books that I was not supposed to read. I was supposed to read after a certain age, but not quite yet. And then, of course, it was one of the books that I did read. And it was phenomenal because all of my family experiences were somewhat there, but they were also in my own language. And usually my relatives told them in different languages, not in my native Italian. So it was, for me, a coming home, even though it was a very unsettling home. In any case, the reason why that book was there is also, and then it became my own book, because in 1976, an edition of This Is a Man became essentially mandatory reading in public schools in Italy. And the issue there is not just that of, as we would call today, Holocaust education. But that book has helped shaping the way in which Italians read and use the Italian language since. So what happened through that motion, through that passage of Primo Levi from the list of forbidden books for children to the list of mandatory books for young people in Italy, was that a classic came into being. And in a way, these six categories, these six qualities, values, literary values that Calvino lists, are the stuff of a classic. So I think I have a couple of suggestions for you tonight, if you want to take up the challenge. One is to maybe pick one or two of these and see how they resonate with you, with your reading of Primo Levi. And then to take the conversation from there, thinking about how the translation of the complete works of Levi into English may foster a conversation about the fact that maybe this is the work of a classic who's not just a classic in the Italian language, but maybe also in other languages, and how does that work? How do we move forward? And to sort of wrap up my initial question, which is not a question, it's more of a request, right? I also wanted to note that although many of the readings, that the wonderful and poignant reading that preceded us, and also a lot of the public conversations around Levi begin with his memoirs and with If This Is a Man, If It's a Questo Un Uomo, the 18 chapters of This Is a Man are about 200 pages. You probably know exactly the number of pages, but 200 pages out of 3,000. So we have a chance here to really think more broadly, and to think and have a conversation in English about this. So this is sort of our mandate for the night. But if you wanted to I don't know, maybe select if you want to take up this challenge and select one or two of these literary values and see how they apply to your own reading and translating in your case, and of Primo Levi, would you like to start?
I would immediately leapt to exactitude, particularly as a translator, I think. I mean, Levi's language is so exact. I mean, he was a scientist, and he used all the skills of a scientist, the particular skills of a scientist, in his writing. His descriptions are very specific. They're very particular and concrete. And not only in his writing about Auschwitz, which was really, I think, astonishing in that way, where he talked about what people did, what the day was like, what the night was like, but in his other writing as well, in the Periodic Table, his memoir, based on the elements of the Periodic Table, well, not based on exactly, but each chapter, you probably know this, is takes off from an element of the Periodic Table. Many of them are actually about the element, some of them are less so, but he talks about scientific processes, scientific operations, mechanical processes, and in a very particular way. Not so easy for the translator all the time, but it's very amazing. And I'll just say one more thing about exactitude. In his other writing, also in his writing, he wrote a lot of science fiction. It's not really science fiction, but sort of science fiction type stories, just to spread out over those 3,000 pages. He was also very exact. I mean, these are usually quite short stories, but each one creates a kind of little world that is very particular, very specific, and very vivid, really. So that's exactitude.
Yeah, I think just to talk about the range a little bit, about what's in these three volumes, I think when we think of Levi, we think usually of the book If This Is a Man, which was originally translated in English as Survival in Auschwitz, and in this edition, the original Italian title has been restored, and maybe also The Periodic Table, his memoir, and The Drowned and the Saved, which is the book that he wrote many years later, looking back on his Auschwitz experience. But there are also many other books and essays and short stories included in this edition. He wrote a second memoir called The Truce about his return home from Auschwitz. He wrote a novel about a Jewish partisan band during World War II based on extensive research. And then he wrote these sort of whimsical, almost short stories. There's a series of short stories, for example, about a salesman for an American company named Simpson, I think, who sells a series of ever more outlandish inventions, one of which is copier that can copy things in three dimensions, sort of like a 3D printer. And it's interesting to read these stories to see how these inventions have come true in a certain way. But then someone gets a hold of it and realizes, well, what if we started copying people? Or what if we started copying diamonds? We could be incredibly rich. There are little sort of scientific parables like that about technology and the dangers of technology. But I think that there is, for me at least, there's at least some resistance in thinking about Levi as a literary writer, because even though he was obviously a literary writer, what he's writing about is also testimony. What he's writing about is his own experiences in Auschwitz and what they meant. And we don't read that in the same way as we read a regular book, an ordinary book. And Levi is in a sort of category with a very few other writers. I think of him as being in a category with writers like Solzhenitsyn or Elie Wiesel, obviously, or even someone like George Orwell, who went through the worst parts of the 20th century and stood for certain values, stood for certain humanistic values. And so for me, all of these qualities in his writing, which are definitely there, are expressions of this determination to bear witness accurately, but also to maintain some sort of honor as a human being after going through these desperate experiences. So there's a moral quality to these literary qualities.
So definitely having a conversation about Levi that is not also a conversation about history, that one, you know, with a capital H, rather than about his writings, it's always problematic, right? So much so that when Levi himself debuted as a straight, it's San Francisco, we can use this word, a straight writer with a collection of fiction, the short story published in 1966, A Storie Naturali, Natural Histories, he did so under a pseudonym. The pseudonym was Damiano Malabaila. And there is some discussion about whether this was a request of the publisher. The publisher didn't want him to put out a book that was a book of fiction and not a memoir with his own name. But we do know that he picked the pseudonym. And it's a very emblematic pseudonym. The last name, Malabaglia, essentially means evil nurse.
But wasn't it also the name of a plumber?
It was, but he argued that he just caught the name out of a plumbing supply store in Turin, which is entirely possible. However, I'm sure there were many other signs in Turin that he could have picked, and not this one. By the way, today I checked, if you look, there is a Damiano Malabaglia profile on Facebook, and there is a Damiano Malabaglia handle on Twitter that tweets about Primo Levi. So the pseudonym has a life of its own, clearly. But aside from picking this pseudonym and either being politely asked by the publisher or choosing to have it, and to have this one, he does, in describing his work as a fiction writer, say that these are divertissement, that it's not almost like something not to be taken too seriously. And yet, at the same time, even in the most extreme of fiction and science fiction, I'm thinking, for example, of the it's a short story, it's really a play of Sleeping Beauty in the fridge, mm-hmm. Where this lady has lived, young woman has lived for a long, long time, frozen, and wakes up. He's woken up only a few minutes or hours every so often, and then turns out to having been abused by her custodians. So there's always an undertone there.
I think that's true.
Right? We're always torn between giving full literary credentials and mm-hmm. then history coming back through the window and mm-hmm. and really pushing us into a corner in a way.
I think it's, isn't it also true that he wrote a kind of, I don't know if it was exactly an introduction, but not an introduction to that first book, Natural Histories, or his second book, I guess. But he also, it was clear, although it was written under pseudonym, it was clear that he was the author. Isn't there that thing that was either on the cover or they ran a kind of band across the book, mm-hmm. where he says the author of this is is known for these, for writing a memoir, but he's also the author of this. So it was, even though it was a pseudonym, people knew who it was.
Yeah. It was no Elena Ferrante. It was not Elena Ferrante.
Yeah. So it was, but it's certainly true that that there is that tension, I guess, between history and literary work. I guess he felt that himself. I mean, I think he was eager to be seen as a literary writer, a literary person, a writer, and he talks a lot about that. I mean, he struggled a lot with it because when he finally quit his job as a chemist and sort of became a writer full time, he talked about it a lot. I mean, he was nervous about it, I think. But anyway, there is that tension.
And some of those science fiction stories are also very serious sort of parables. There's one, I think, the title story in the book, Flaw of Form, which is about a soul in heaven, and the soul is being offered the chance to be incarnated, to be born on Earth, and the people telling him what life is like on Earth are basically giving him a sort of hard sell and only focusing on the good parts. And then gradually, as the story goes on, he begins to see there's also war, there's aging, there's sickness and death, racism. And in the end, this soul says, I'm willing to be born on Earth, but only if I can go through the worst that people go through. I don't want any special treatment or any special privileges. I want to have to suffer with the people who are suffering. So it starts out as a sort of a science fiction story, but it ends up being a story about on what conditions is life worth living. So he does manage to connect both sides of his writing.
And yet, and on the other hand, as I was trying to suggest, his writing, the quality of his Italian, is that of what becomes a form of canonical Italian as shaped literary language and public language in Italy since it appeared and see enter the public arena. So there is a literary quality there that is somewhat independent of the content, of the historical content of the memoir, and that stays, that remains to this day, that is still perceivable. In that sense, I think that Calvino's qualities are very much at play here. And what happens is that possibly, and this is really a question for the translator too, the echoes of high literature, both Italian and world literature, in his writing, the exact writings of a scientist, are very much present. They are echoes that are part of his upbringing. Primo Levi went to the classical, Liceo Classico, the classical high school in Torino, Liceo d'Azeglio, where he not only was exposed during the years of fascism to an anti-fascist environment, but also acquired the intellectual tools that opened up, and this is the old educational system of Italy, opened up all of the classics of you know, Latin and Greek and of course, high Italian literature. So it's no surprise that he's able to quote Dante by memory even in Auschwitz, right? Because it's part of his intellectual DNA. Now the question is, how does this very complex literary world work in the work of the translator? To an Italian reader, it is both Dante, but it's also the Dante that is learned in school that passes through the pages. So I'm wondering what kind of considerations are there? And again, my question here is, what happens to this? Like, what happens to these qualities that are there in its English, the lingua franca of the 21st century incarnation?
Well, just on a practical level.
Just to put a little bit of responsibility on you, make sure that, you know, have enough.
In my usual fashion, I'll answer on a concrete level. I mean, there's the question of references, particularly in Levi, literary references, particularly Dante. Manzoni is another one, where Italian readers get the references and English readers don't get it. I mean, you won't I mean, in the Canto of Ulysses, which is the famous chapter of this is a man, where he tries to remember this, the canto about Ulysses and Dante in the Inferno. That's clear that he's talking about Dante in a very overt way. But there are many other places where there's a quotation from Dante that an Italian reader will recognize. It doesn't have to be pointed out. So the question is, the practical question is, are you going to point it out or not? Are you going to just let it go by? Are you going to have a footnote or what? So, you know, there's kind of a balance of footnotes and not footnotes. And but there's no way to, I don't think there's any way to make the Dante references or any of the literary references classical to an American or Anglophone reader. I mean, I think that there's been work done. Levi apparently in the first version of, or in earlier versions of If This Is a Man, he had many more literary references, many more overt literary references, which he eventually removed, I think. I think there's a book that's been done about this, that's Alberto Cavallone. I think in that book he talks about all this. So I think it's there. You can study it, but I think you just have to take it on faith. You the English reader. So I don't know if that's a good solution. Do you have a better one?
No, of course not. That's why I'm just moderating this. Otherwise, I, of course. Adam, what do you think of this idea of a classic? Do you think it holds beyond the Italian context?
Well, it's interesting to think of a book like If This Is a Man as a classic, in part because it is a book that so many people read as young people in school. I think that's true here, too. It's a book that is often the book that young people learn about the Holocaust by reading, what Auschwitz was, from a book like this, or Night. Those are the two, I think, books that are most often assigned. And in, I think there's an afterword to If This Is a Man, in which he talks about, Levi talks about his experiences dealing with students. He says, I would often be invited to go to schools and in Italy and also in Germany, I think, and talk to students about what he had written. And he talks about some of the questions that he got. And the questions were things like, on the one hand, why didn't you fight back? Why didn't you resist? And on the other hand, do you forgive? And he describes how there's a strong pressure, especially in a Catholic country, for the Jew to be seen forgiving, that if you were overcoming your anger, you were embracing the sort of Christian value of forgiveness. And he fights back against that. He says, I forgive people who ask for forgiveness, but if someone doesn't ask for forgiveness, then they're still my enemy, and I don't forgive someone who's my enemy. And there's a sort of amazing story, I think it's in the periodic table, where he talks about corresponding with a man who he knew in Auschwitz, named Müller, I think, who was one of the German scientists who was in charge of the chemistry lab where he was working as a prisoner. And then 15 years later, Levi, who was a chemist in a paint factory, ended up having a business correspondence with this man, and he realized that it was the man who had been his superior officer in Auschwitz. And he talks about the correspondence that they had and how this German wanted his forgiveness. He wanted to prove that he had done things right, that he had tried to help, and that was his memory of what had happened in Auschwitz. And Levi refuses to allow him to get away with this. He says, no, in fact, you didn't try to help. There were people who did risk things to help, but you weren't one of them. And the man desperately wants to meet with him in order to have it out. And then just before they can meet, he dies. Müller dies. And so it's this unreconciled relationship. And so I think that he was very conscious of being an educator, that he was explaining what this historical event was for people who weren't going to know it themselves. And he was conscious of that responsibility. And I think that he really did an amazing job of that, which is one reason why people love him and honor him, because when you read his books, you come to grips not only with, as people have said, what a day in Auschwitz was like, in a way that I don't know if any other book tells you that, but also, especially in his later work, what it means and what are the lessons that you can draw from it.
in this, and he describes himself as a centaur, an animal that is two at once, right? And that is both in terms of his scientific and literary minds, of his being a witness and being a writer. And he's also, and I remember this just by virtue of growing up in Italy when he was alive, and he was a public intellectual. He was on television very often and interviewed on all kinds of topics. He felt always, at the same time, very approachable. His role, as you were mentioning, going into public schools and speaking with students, and at the same time, also very distant, very removed. And I wanted to ask both of you if you think that this is something that is perceivable through his writings, and how you negotiate through this duality.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's fair.
You get very intimate with a writer when you're translating them. I don't know that that's exactly, if you're really intimate with the person, if you don't know the person, but you do definitely have a sense of a person. And I don't, there is a kind of often a kind of ironic tone which in Levi, which is sort of distancing. But it's also, there's also very, a kind of warmth that isn't obvious, I think, and a kind of emotion that isn't necessarily obvious when you first read him. So I guess I feel that it's hard to know because I wasn't a student in a school, unfortunately, where Levi, but it was very important to him, to talk to students and to tell his story. I mean, that's really what was...
I guess I was also inspired by the two photos that were chosen for this. And this is not going to go well over the radio waves, but there is a photo on the side of the three volumes. And I was sitting in the audience earlier and felt that Primo Levi was really looking at all of us with a very critical gaze. And then the back of the box of the three volumes has a much more welcoming tone. It's a photograph. It's also a portrait of his, and it's a way more welcoming one. Adam, how do you feel about the duality, both self-described and perhaps perceived, of Primo Levi?
Well, it's true that he's someone who writes about himself extensively in certain parts of his life, in certain ways, and then in other parts he doesn't tell you anything at all. So he's not really a confessional kind of writer. He's not someone who wants to tell you everything about his life. I don't think he writes at all about his marriage, for example. There's one particular episode in which he says that he's not going to tell you about it, which is when he was fighting with a partisan unit. The reason that he ended up in Auschwitz was not simply a house-to-house search, the way some people were deported to Auschwitz, but that he was caught fighting in a partisan band against the German occupiers in Italy after Mussolini had been deposed. He says, I don't want to talk about this episode, and it obviously pains him. There's obviously something going on in that experience that he doesn't want you to know about. And then in one point when he talks about it, I think this is also in the periodic table, he says that while he was a partisan, he and his fellow partisans executed one of their members. He doesn't tell you exactly why, but he says that they felt that it was necessary. And he's obviously very ashamed and very... torn up about this experience still. He doesn't want to talk about it. So there are limits. There are limits to what he's going to reveal. I think that he is very outward turning as a writer. He's very focused on the outward, external world, the way things work. He's very especially interested in the way things work, both on the level of chemistry and the level of psychology and institutions. But he's not the kind of writer who you feel is letting you in and becoming your friend in a certain way. So there is a sort of distance.
And would you like to tell us a bit about the making of this project? It was a 10-year, actually, earlier, before we came. Yeah. I said 10, you said 11. But who was counting, right? 11 years of work, and also negotiating with multiple translations of some of the works and no translation at all for others. How did it all
It was the vision of an editor called Robert Weil at Norton, the publisher Norton, and he decided he wanted to publish the complete works of Primo Levi. He had always loved Levi since he was a child, I think. But so it took him. The English rights were scattered all over the place. It took him 5 years to get together the English rights to Levi's work, and then he needed someone who spoke Italian or knew Italian to sort of be the editor of it. And that's where I came in, which was in 2004. and we realized, once we started looking at the translations that were available, that the original idea was just to put together the existing translations. It turned out that the translations were very ununiform, not only in style and in who the translators were, in when they were translated, but many of Levi's short pieces, his essays and stories, hadn't been published in English in the way they were published in Italian. And so we decided to make the bold move of translating everything again. The one exception was If This Is a Man, which we could never get the English rights to. But then it turned out the original translator was still alive and had always wanted to redo his translation. So that was a lucky break. So we could advertise it as all new translations. But so there were, I think there are 9 translators. I translated 3 of the books myself, and then several of the other translators translated 2 each. But there was a long haul, because the books, you know, people worked at different speeds. They had to be edited. The idea was to make it to as great an extent as possible a uniform voice, because it's one writer. I mean, it's writing in different types of writing, but nevertheless the same person. So I guess that's how it all happened. And there were moments, as I was saying earlier, that when we weren't sure it was ever going to happen. But then at a certain point we realized, wait, we're only 2 translations are missing. We can do it. And we did eventually.
Can you share some other types of challenges, more on the intellectual or the translating part of it, like stumbling blocks or moments that you feel like were harder to resolve?
Well, I mean, one thing I did allude to was the question of references. You know, how are you going to deal with a lot of things that are that would be known to the general reader in Italian? Another thing was, well, you mentioned that the takeover of Italy by the of Northern Italy by the Germans, September 8th, 1943, is a date that every Italian knows, whereas I doubt whether any American knows the meaning of it. There are several references to that, and so, you know, do you make a footnote? I think Levi explains it in one place. So these kind of very detailed, I mean, that's one kind of challenge. The second challenge, which I think I also alluded to, is the science. I mean, there are a lot of descriptions that are quite beautiful of scientific processes. The last chapter of the periodic table is the history of a carbon atom, which is both very precisely scientific and also quite poetic. So that's a hard balance to strike, I think. So those are a few examples of the practical challenges, I think.
And Adam, would you like to share some challenges in reading Primo Levi for me?
Well, I read these books in English. I don't read Italian, so to me, this is Primo Levi for me. And I think it will be for millions of people in America and England and probably in other places as well. Well, one thing that I think reading Levi in this format brings home is that he had interests that were formed by his experience in Auschwitz, or maybe brought out by them, that he continued to develop and apply in other areas of life and other genres of writing. So for instance, there's a book of his called The Wrench. I think it was originally published as The Monkey Wrench. In this translation, it's called The Wrench. It's a very unusual book. It's basically a series of stories told by a fictional character named Fausone, right, who's a rigger, he rigs cranes and bridges. So he does dangerous, difficult, high-altitude construction work. And he's telling stories about the jobs that he's done and his experiences to a narrator who's very much like Primo Levi. And the two of them are together, I think, in Eastern Europe at a job site. And at night, they get together, and this man tells him stories. It's an unusual book because it has no plot, really. It's a series of anecdotes, more or less. And the anecdotes are all about things like, how do you build a bridge, or how do you build an oil rig in an ocean storm? But what the book is really about is work. And Levi is someone who values work very highly. For him, work, dignified work, meaningful work, is really the most important thing in life. It's the source of freedom. And it's fascinating because here's someone who was in Auschwitz, where on the gates it says, work makes you free. Arbeit macht frei. And that is what Levi believes. He believes that work makes you free. And I think that his experience in Auschwitz of work that was horribly distorted, work that was turned into a punishment and a curse and never amounted to anything, really reinforced in him the idea that work is important and is liberating and a good thing. There's a passage in one of, I don't remember where it is, when he talks about how opposed he is to the idea that work is a negative thing, that if we could only get free of it, we wouldn't have to do it, we could just let machines do it. And he says, no, work is one of the best things in human life. One of his jobs was working in this chemistry laboratory where the job in the Buna camp in Auschwitz was to produce rubber, artificial rubber. And after years and all the lives lost and all the work that was done, no rubber was actually produced. So it was an example of completely wasted work, completely artificial work. And for Levi, I think that reinforced this idea that genuine work is important. For him, that work often took the form of chemistry. And this is something that relates in an interesting way to Levi as a Jewish writer, which is an identity that, as we were talking about earlier, he was ambivalent about. He did not necessarily want to be known as a Jewish writer, even though his experiences had so much to do with being Jewish. But in the periodic table, he says one reason why he wanted to study chemistry is that he felt that his ancestors, the men in his Jewish community, had lost the use of their hands. They didn't know how to do anything with their hands. He says the women knew how to do things with their hands because they could cook, they could sew, but the men were all professionals, they're scholars or lawyers, and they didn't know how to build things or make things. And for him, chemistry was a way to regain that prowess, to be able to use your hands again. So even in that early of a stage, because he became a chemistry student, of course, before the war, before his camp experience, he was thinking about work and the meaning of work and work as a positive thing.
Thank you. Another important aspect of translating Primo Levi into English has to do with the history of the North American reception of his works. There was one glitch, right? With If Not Now, When? This epic novel that Levi wrote detailing the history of a fictional group of Jewish East European freedom fighters, partisans, and their journey all the way to eventually across, at the end of World War II, across the Brenner and into Italy, and then on their way to Palestine. And it was a book that many critics in Italy, in the U.S., perceived as not genuine. And it was sort of like, it had almost like a lesser status in his production. I'm suggesting to think about this relationship of reader and, you know, international readers and his work in connection with that phenomenal interview that Philip Roth did with Levi, in which there is a crucial, I mean, there are several crucial passages, but there is one that I at least stayed with me, has been staying with me for a long time, and has to do with the idea of the Jewish experience as an experience of uprootedness in Roth's sort of view. And Levi says, wait a second, except for the 10 months that I was in Birkenau, I've always lived here. I was born, that the family lore says that I was born on the exact spot where my desk is, where I write now. Right? So my, it says, he claims, mine is an experience of rootedness. And that's a very clear pattern in the Italian Jewish experience that doesn't really translate well into other types of, you know, I'm fond of calling Italian Jews as marginal cosmopolitans, right? And so it doesn't really translate into that broad context. If both of you can reflect on this topic, that would be great. Anne? Adam,
please go ahead.
She's going to take a little time.
I think that one reason why Levi speaks to American Jewish readers in particular is that his experience is very much like ours. When we read about the Holocaust in Eastern Europe, it seems like a different world. It seems like a different century almost. And even though that's where most of our ancestors came from, it's hard to imagine the way of life in a shtetl, in the Soviet Union, these places where most of the killing took place. Whereas when Levi describes his childhood as a completely assimilated, completely integrated, urban, not very religious Italian Jew, that seems very familiar, I think. That is the way a lot of American Jews live as well. And so it's true that there's this paradox about him. He was extremely rooted. He lived his entire life in the same apartment. He died in the same building where he was born. So for 66 of his 67 years, he lived in the same place. But the other year was in Auschwitz. So you know, you can't say that you're rooted if it's possible to be so radically uprooted. And I think that that speaks to American Jewish fears as well, that if you think that you're completely rooted in a place, and then it turns out that within the space of a couple of years you can be destroyed from it, what does that mean about your rootedness? He talks about the period when the Italian fascism was not always anti-Semitic, and in fact, in its first years, many Italian Jews supported it. It was only towards the end of the 30s when Mussolini became drawn under Hitler's sort of influence even more that the laws for the defense of the race were passed and Jews were excluded from schools, for example. And Levi writes about how he belonged to this demographic cohort that under the law, if you were Jewish, you weren't allowed to enter a university, but if you were already in a university, you could finish your degree. And that was the situation that he and his friends were in. And he says that in a way this was a disaster for them because they had spent their lives in pursuit of a conventional kind of success, which was going to lead up to a university degree. And it was 1940 or 41. And they said, well, we're going to stay and finish our degree. And as a result of that, they lost 1939. They lost the year when they could have left because they decided to stay and finish their degrees. And so that, to me, is a very haunting story because it makes you think about how in certain moments in Jewish history you have to be ready to leave everything and leave the society where you thought you were going to flourish and integrate. So that question of rootedness and uprootedness, I think, is a fascinating one with him.
Well, to go back to your original, to the starting point of if not now, when, I think that Italian Jews all had no, American Jews, for even though they do have that sort of assimilated, pretty assimilated, rooted feeling, also have a much deeper connection to Eastern European Jews and to the shtetls and to Russia. And I think that Levi spent 8 months or 9 months studying Yiddish and Eastern European history, I mean, the history of the Jews in Eastern Europe, in Russia, and that's how he wrote his novel. So it was sort of based on, I mean, it was somewhat based on his own experience. His return from Auschwitz took place, he spent a lot of time in Russia. In a slightly different circumstances, but I think that it was that because the novel was based on that on his reading in a sense, it maybe rang a little less true to Americans. I mean, it might have seemed as if it came from a literary experience in a funny way, which isn't really about rootedness and uprootedness, but somewhat.
And there's also, I feel like, with that book, this desire to write about Jews who fought back, right?
Well, yeah, there was that, right, that's another aspect of it.
That
right.
There's almost a sort of wish fulfillment fantasy element to it. That, yeah. And not that Jewish partisans didn't exist, but that his experience was was not that. And so the idea that he wanted to imagine his way into this, in a way, more positive Jewish experience where the Jews take up guns and they fight back and they kill Germans and they manage to escape, might have felt like inauthentic or wish fulfillment compared to what he had actually lived through.
Thank you. I think it's time now to be rejoined by our fantastic readers. So let me help with some chairs. And our first question goes specifically to our readers, and hopefully we can share this microphone, I think. If you could each tell us why and how you selected what you read. Richard Rodriguez.
I'm a memoirist, and I'm attracted to the memoir as a agency of revelation, but also its secrecies. And I was very interested in Levi, first of all, the biographical fact of his death, which is ultimately described as an accident or a suicide. And what's interesting, apparently, is that there's no written testimony from him as to what the event meant, and that we have these memoirs of this life lived within camps of death, and in the presence of death, and the spectacle of the gaudiness of death, and then the survival, which becomes this other period of the public intellectual, the memoirist, remembering. And what interested me, I think, in the story of Henri is this young man, androgynous, beautiful, seductive, pretending this compassion with his SS guards, that here was a man who had survived the camp. But in some way, I think Levi intends us to see that he lost his soul in the process. Well, that's a very interesting dilemma, and I think what I wanted to do in my little reading was to suggest that survival was not all, that many times there was haunting, and there was a life after survival, which was burdensome, and maybe so burdensome that the memoirist never told us about it.
Robert Haas?
Well, I picked the poems I picked because they seem to go straight to the experience of Auschwitz. And I think one of the reasons all of us came to read Levi was because we wanted the testimony that those events are still the center of the moral universe. I think for anybody who's alive now, you measure almost anything you do in relation to how that behavior might have been had you been forced to act in that world. And so it's one of the reasons Levi and Wiesel, so many of those writers are terrific magnets for our imaginations. And those poems spoke to that. In a more particular way for me, everything sounds so gorgeous in Italian.
Even Polish, I was, you mean.
I was living in Rome, and I reading as much Italian poetry as I could and talking to some of the Italian poets about it. And someone said, well, have you read Levi's poems? And I didn't even know he had written poems. And I said no, and I immediately went out and found them. And for a couple of weeks, it became my practice to try to, with an Italian dictionary, to try to read those poems and be nearer to that man who, yes.
And Germanicus.
Just very briefly, I knew that we would move into talk of the Holocaust and of Levi as a Holocaust writer and a memoirist, and I wanted to just focus on him solely as a writer, and I think that comes through in the poem that I read. Maybe it's wishful thinking to do that. It's impossible, as as Bob just said, but I wanted to grant him that and honor him in that way.
And that's the tension that we've been trying to discuss, and it's time to open it to questions from the audience. So there is a microphone going around. Thank you, Stephanie.
And if you have a question, just wait till I come to you with the mic so everyone can hear you.
Thank you. I have two questions, one for Anne. Do you agree with Francesco's opinion that Levi influenced the use of language in Italy? And if you agree with it, can you give an example? And the other question I have is, it is intriguing to me that only Richard invoked the circumstances of Levi's death. And I wonder if any of the other panelists believe that there is an answer to this mystery as to whether it was an accidental death or a suicide that can be gleaned from the work that he left behind.
Well, I really can't answer to about the influence of Levi as a writer in Italian. Maybe you should answer that.
My very quick answer to that is actually reflecting what you were saying. You were talking about Alessandro Manzoni's role in shaping the Italian language. The entrance of Levi's work, along with Calvino and a few others, into the canon of mandatory readings in public school coincides with the eclipse of Manzoni's works. So it's a moment in which the canon is switched, and it is the middle of the 1970s for a number of reasons that are political, institutional, etc. But it's also the ethos of the country in a way that I think is reflected in this passage. But the microphone goes back to you about the death of Primo Levi, if you wish to take that.
No, question. I don't.
I don't actually.
Yeah.
I mean, yes.
He died. Then it's known how he died. It's not known why or really.
Next question is back here.
Yes. In fact, it's about the death of Primo Levi. I was in Torino, and I was so surprised. I went to his house because I wanted to see, it's someone that I... And there is nothing, not a plaque, nothing, not a sign. And, I was so shocked because here I hear you, he's a monument, he has changed Italian the language, and not one sign. And I had such a shock for me. And I don't know who I have to talk to, and here you have the consul general. Perhaps they can do something that in Torino, at the place where he lived, there is a sign. And it was so important for me. I felt so betrayed in a way that I waited that someone got out of the house, and I just went and I saw the stairs, and I recited the three or four words of Kaddish I know.
The piazza in front of the synagogue called the Primo Levi.
The piazza in front of the synagogue is called Piazzetta Primo Levi, named after him, but not at his house. But I would say there are also issues of privacy and of his family.
His family,
which has had, over the decades, a very deep involvement with the legacy and also practically. They are constantly submerged by letters and requests from all over the world.
And they control
everything. And so it's probably, but it's also a way to create a bit of a, I believe, much needed buffer between the legacy and sort of everyday life.
Next question is back here.
I had a question about his Jewish observance. It was noted that he wasn't particularly observant, and yet the poem that was read had the cadence of the Via Hafta. It's almost...
It's entitled Shema.
Oh, Shema.
The title is Shema.
I didn't hear that. I'm so sorry.
It is very much...
Okay, but then maybe you can
paraphrase.
Speak to if he was not observant, how did he come to write, or how might he have come to write... that particular piece.
Thank you. I could speak about this, but I don't. Adam, would you? Come on. Do we flip a coin?
I think that one does get a sense from the books that he was part of a very self-conscious Jewish community, that he knew his ancestors and the language that they spoke, the dialect that they spoke, but that he didn't believe in God, and he wasn't practicing and observant. However, he probably knew the Bible. He probably had gone to synagogue enough to know some of the liturgy.
Yeah, I in knowing that bunch of Piemontese Jews in their development, you know, they were emancipated in 1848. They came out of the ghettos. They very quickly joined society. Until then, they were not allowed to go to university. They weren't allowed to join into liberal professions or anything like that. They jumped into society. They had a very pivotal role in the shaping of the unification of Italy. They were deeply secular in their lives, and there was always a portion of them that wasn't, and that kept traditions alive and kept them on. And I mean, I know what they wrote in the previous, you know, 150 years, and they constantly lamented how much tradition was being lost, and at the same time, how much modernity was important. And so both identities kind of coexisted. So personally, I don't see any contradiction in that. It's very much part of the ethos of the way in which most of them lived, and some of them continue to live to this day. So in which the two dimensions coexist, both a deep knowledge and love for texts and heritage and discussion, a lot of that in Turin to this day, and also a very deeply secular mentality and mindset and engagement with public life.
Well, just add that the chapter Argon in the periodic table, I think, captures what you just said pretty perfectly.
Allen Ginsberg was a secular Jew, and his great poem was called Kaddish.
Yeah. And yeah, thank you for reminding
Seamus
us
Heaney
of that
was
detail.
Not particularly religious Catholic, and his poems are full of the rhythms of those prayers. I don't think anybody writes poetry without the language of prayer from their childhood enter into the rhythms of their writing.
I actually have a question. I wanted to know, Anne, but also all of you, now that we have the complete works here for the English reader, as you've encountered Primo Levi, what has surprised you the most about him?
Well, I was surprised by the range of his interests, by the range of his imagination, the range of his ability to capture so many different aspects of his own mind in a way, as well as of the external world. But I would say that really it's a question of his range and versatility, maybe.
Thank you. I had a question touched off in part by a comment Adam had made about 1939 to 1940. And so in terms of, let's say, scholarship and research, and maybe no one here is in that position, but I'm interested if you have heard, was he on a path to get an elite education in chemistry? Or was it just a fairly standard education in chemistry?
He had a doctorate in chemistry from the University of Turin.
Okay, so now is that what he was finishing?
He completed his degree. And as you can read in his books, a lot of his textbooks were in German, because that was the standard in Europe in those days, which enabled him to qualify for
right and would give him the confidence
for a lab job in
to write that book.
Monowitz.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Some clarification about Primo Levi. He was depressed for many years. It's well known. But it is another aspect that's not touched about that Primo Levi is very much used by us psychoanalysts in understand traumatic event and the idea of dehumanization. I do think there's a large body of literature, psychoanalytical literature, right now that we always start with Primo Levi in order to understand what happened if somebody's been traumatized, what happened to this mind, and also what happened in terms of the identity that fails after the trauma. I think this Levi really opens another avenue, a very important avenue, on the study of the mind and the suffering and recognition from another.
Okay, we have last one, two, three questions.
It's a very difficult time in Europe now, and also in Italy too, I think. In any way, is the view of Primo Levi changing at all? He's still, read in the schools. Is that, do you think it's likely to change? I hope not.
I don't think so. There's the Centro Primo Levi in Torino, one of its big missions is to keep Levi alive, in particular in the schools. And they go around all over Italy promoting Levi, I guess you could say. But I think he's still read, right?
He's still read and also appropriated and oftentimes misappropriated in public discourse. Mm-hmm. The title, If This Is a Man, is applied to all kinds of contexts in public life, which is also a sign of the fact that it remains a component of public awareness.
Next question over here.
This is for everyone. I'm just curious, what is your favorite personal piece of writing by Primo Levi?
Periodic Table. It's an astonishingly original book.
Same.
I think if you have already read If This Is a Man, which is sort of like the basic one, then The Periodic Table is probably the second one to read. It's a really interesting and unusual book.
I guess I would say The Periodic Table, but I think that The Truce is also a really wonderful book.
I was going for The Truce. Oh, okay. That I cast my vote for The Truce. A masterpiece, a literary
really
masterpiece.
Amazing.
I'm the high school student. I probably would name If This Is a Man, just because the title is enchanting already. It is already a puzzle as to whether it's a question, a declaration, or again, an admission of our human failure.
Thank you. We have time for one last question right over here.
I just wanted to ask one very quick and run a little longer. The first question is, I just found out recently that on his tombstone, there's only his Auschwitz number. That's very interesting in itself, but I was wondering if any of you know whether that was his wish. That's one question. The second question is got to do with, speaking of unfinished or incomplete relationships like Miller, I wonder if any of you care to mention their idea about Jean Méry, who was a parallel intellectual, sharing the same experience, except that he really was in Auschwitz digging ditches and so on. And at the end of his life, or toward the end of his life, Levi, in The Drown and the Save, dedicates a chapter to Jean Méry, almost out of the blue. And Méry had written lots of times about Levi's writings and about the challenge of the intellectual in an environment like Auschwitz. So I'm wondering whether, I think Améry ought to be mentioned in any discussion of Levi.
I mean, one way to tie a couple of things that have been mentioned together is that there's so Jean Améry, whose real name was Hans Meyer, Améry was the anagram of Meyer, was another Holocaust writer and an Auschwitz survivor who claimed that he had met Levi in Auschwitz, although Levi said that he didn't remember meeting Améry. There's a whole chapter in The Drowned and the Saved, which is basically a descent from Améry, who was tortured in Auschwitz and wrote about how once, Améry says, once you're tortured, the world is broken and you can never really live again after that. And Levi descends from that, and he says, he devotes a whole chapter to explaining why his experience was different from Amiri's and why his interpretation of it was different. And it ties into the question of his suicide, because Amiri did commit suicide, and as did many other Holocaust writers, of course, like Jerzy Kosinski or Paul Celan. It's a common story. And Levi in that chapter, as much as seems to be saying, I am not going to commit suicide the way Jean Amiri did, because my experience of Auschwitz was different and my what I came away with was different. And that's why I think the question of whether he committed suicide is so important to the way we read his work, because if it turns out that he was unable to do that, he was unable to transcend, overcome, or face the experience, and that in the end the experience destroyed him, then that changes the way we read all of his books. There's a theory that the way he died, probably most people know, but if you don't know, is that he fell or jumped over the railing of a staircase in his apartment building. And there's a theory which says that this was a low railing. He was on medication, which might have affected his sense of balance. He didn't leave a suicide note. He probably wouldn't have chosen to commit suicide in such a way that could have left him paralyzed or injured. These are the reasons that are given by people who believe that he did not commit suicide, that he died accidentally. I know that in the edition, in the chronology, it says simply he died of suicide. And that, I think, is the most accepted view of what happened.
What about the grave?
That I don't know.
I don't know.
I actually don't know either about the grave. I just wanted to add to this that it's very clear that Levi is an avid reader of for the sake of brevity, the Holocaust literature. And he also argues, albeit much more briefly, with Paul Celan in a short essay, which is a manifesto against obscure writing.
Oh, yeah.
And he cites Celan as an example of that, and not in, even though he's an admirer of Celan's poetry, it becomes an example of how not to write about the Holocaust in a way. Your question could be expanded in how Levi reads other survivors' memoirs and work in general. And I guess that's not for the next translation of these, but because we're not going for that, but for another conversation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Everybody. Robert Haas.
I just wanted to say, having done some translation, that we owe this work to Anne,
exactly.
And that we owe her great thanks.
I was about to say thank you, Anne Goldstein, for being here with us and presenting this work.
Not very religious Italian Jew, that seems very familiar, I think. That is the way a lot of American Jews live as well. And so it's true that there's this paradox about him. He was extremely rooted. He lived his entire life in the same apartment. He died in the same building where he was born. So for 66 of his 67 years, he lived in the same place. But the other year was in Auschwitz. So, you know, you can't say that you're rooted if it's possible to be so radically uprooted. And I think that speaks to American Jewish fears as well, that if you think that you're completely rooted in a place, and then it turns out that within the space of a couple of years you can be destroyed from it, what does that mean about your rootedness? He talks about the period when the Italian fascism was not always anti-Semitic, and in fact, in its first years, many Italian Jews supported it. It was only towards the end of the 30s when Mussolini became drawn under Hitler's sort of influence even more that the laws for the defense of the race were passed and Jews were excluded from schools, for example. And Levi writes about how he belonged to this demographic cohort that under the law, if you were Jewish, you weren't allowed to enter a university, but if you were already in a university, you could finish your degree. And that was the situation that he and his friends were in. And he says that in a way this was a disaster for them because they had spent their lives in pursuit of a conventional kind of success, which was going to lead up to a university degree. And it was 1940 or 41. And they said, well, we're going to stay and finish our degree. And as a result of that, they lost 1939. They lost the year when they could have left because they decided to stay and finish their degrees. And so that, to me, is a very haunting story because it makes you think about how in certain moments in Jewish history you have to be ready to leave everything and leave the society where you thought you were going to flourish and integrate. So that question of rootedness and uprootedness, I think, is a fascinating one with him.
Well, to go back to your original, to the starting point of if not now, when, I think that Italian Jews all had no, American Jews, for even though they do have that sort of assimilated, pretty assimilated, rooted feeling, also have a much deeper connection to Eastern European Jews and to the shtetls and to Russia. And I think that Levi spent 8 months or 9 months studying Yiddish and Eastern European history, I mean, the history of the Jews in Eastern Europe, in Russia, and that's how he wrote his novel. So it was sort of based on, I mean, it was somewhat based on his own experience. His return from Auschwitz took place. He spent a lot of time in Russia in a slightly different circumstances. But I think that it was that because the novel was based on that, on his reading, in a sense, it maybe rang a little less true to Americans. I mean, it might have seemed as if it came from a literary experience in a funny way, which isn't really about rootedness and uprootedness, but somewhat.
And there's also, I feel like, with that book, this desire to write about Jews who fought back, right?
Well, yeah, there was that, right, that's another aspect of it.
That
right.
There's almost a sort of wish fulfillment fantasy element to it. That, yeah. And not that Jewish partisans didn't exist, but that his experience was not that. And so the idea that he wanted to imagine his way into this, in a way, more positive Jewish experience where the Jews take up guns and they fight back and they kill Germans and they manage to escape, might have felt like inauthentic or wish fulfillment compared to what he had actually lived through.
Thank you. I think it's time now to be rejoined by our fantastic readers. So let me help with some chairs. And our first question goes specifically to our readers, and hopefully we can share this microphone, I think. If you could each tell us why and how you selected what you read. Richard Rodriguez.
I'm a memoirist, and I'm attracted to the memoir as a agency of revelation, but also its secrecies. And I was very interested in Levi, first of all, the biographical fact of his death, which is ultimately described as an accident or a suicide. And what's interesting, apparently, is that there's no written testimony from him as to what the event meant, and that we have these memoirs of this life lived within camps of death and in the presence of death and the spectacle of the gaudiness of death, and then the survival, which becomes this other period of the public intellectual, the memoirist, remembering. And what interested me, I think, in the story of Henri is this young man, androgynous, beautiful, seductive, pretending this compassion with his SS guards, that here was a man who had survived the camp. But in some way, I think Levi intends us to see that he lost his soul in the process. Well, that's a very interesting dilemma, and I think what I wanted to do in my little reading was to suggest that survival was not all, that many times there was haunting and there was a life after survival, which was burdensome, and maybe so burdensome that the memoirist never told us about it.
Robert Hans?
Well, I picked the poems I picked because they seem to go straight to the experience of Auschwitz. And I think one of the reasons all of us came to read Levi was because we wanted the testimony that those events are still the center of the moral universe. I think for anybody who's alive now, you measure almost anything you do in relation to how that behavior might have been had you been forced to act in that world. And so it's one of the reasons Levi and Wiesel, so many of those writers are terrific magnets for our imaginations. And those poems spoke to that in a more particular way for me. Everything sounds so gorgeous in Italian.
Even Polish, I was, you mean.
I was living in Rome, and reading as much Italian poetry as I could and talking to some of the Italian poets about it. And someone said, well, have you read Levi's poems? And I didn't even know he had written poems. And I said no, and I immediately went out and found them. And for a couple of weeks, it became my practice to try to, with an Italian dictionary, to try to read those poems and be nearer to that man who, yes.
And Germanicus.
Just very briefly, I knew that we would move into talk of the Holocaust and of Levi as a Holocaust writer and a memoirist, and I wanted to just focus on him solely as a writer, and I think that comes through in the poem that I read. Maybe it's wishful thinking to do that. It's impossible, as Bob just said, but I wanted to grant him that and honor him in that way.
And that's the tension that we've been trying to discuss, and it's time to open it to questions from the audience. So there is a microphone going around. Thank you, Stephanie.
And if you have a question, just wait till I come to you with the mic so everyone can hear you.
Thank you. I have two questions, one for Anne. Do you agree with Francesco's opinion that Levi influenced the use of language in Italy? And if you agree with it, can you give an example? And the other question I have is, it is intriguing to me that only Richard invoked the circumstances of Levi's death. And I wonder if any of the other panelists believe that there is an answer to this mystery as to whether it was an accidental death or a suicide that can be gleaned from the work that he left behind.
Really can't answer to about the influence of Levi as a writer in Italian. Maybe you should answer that.
My very quick answer to that is actually reflecting what you were saying. You were talking about Alessandro Manzoni's role in shaping the Italian language. The entrance of Levi's work, along with Calvino and a few others, into the canon of mandatory readings in public school coincides with the eclipse of Manzoni's works. So it's a moment in which the canon is switched, and it is the middle of the 1970s for a number of reasons that are political, institutional, et cetera, but it's also the ethos of the country in a way that I think is reflected in this passage. But the microphone goes back to you about the death of Primo Levi, if you wish to take that.
No,
question.
I don't.
I don't.
I don't actually.
Yeah. I mean, yes.
He died. Then it's known how he died. It's not known why or really.
Next question is back here.
Yes. In fact, it's about the death of Primo Levi. I was in Torino, and I was so surprised. I went to his house because I wanted to see, you know, it's someone that I... And there is nothing, not a plaque, nothing, not a sign. And, you know, I was so shocked because here I hear you, is a monument, he has changed Italian the language, and not one sign. And I had such a shock for me. And, you know, I don't know who I have to talk to. And here you have the consul general. Perhaps they can do something that in Torino, at the place where he lived, there is a sign. And it was so important for me. I felt so betrayed in a way that I waited that someone got out of the house. And I just went and I saw the stairs. And I recited the three or four words of Kaddish I know.
The piazza in front of the synagogue called the Primo Levi.
The piazza in front of the synagogue is called Piazzetta Primo Levi, named after him, but not at his house. But I mean, I would say there are also issues of privacy and of his family.
His family,
which has had, over the decades, a very deep involvement with the legacy and also practically.
Practically.
I mean, they've been. They are constantly submerged by letters and requests from all over the world.
And they control
everything. And so it's probably, they do, but it's also a way to create a bit of a, I believe, much needed buffer between the legacy and sort of everyday life.
Next question is back here.
I had a question about his Jewish observance. It was noted that he wasn't particularly observant, and yet the poem that was read had the cadence of the Be'ahavta. It's almost...
It's entitled Shema.
Oh, Shema.
The title is Shema.
I didn't hear that. I'm so sorry.
It is very much...
Okay, but then maybe you can
paraphrase.
Speak to if he was not observant, how did he come to write, or how might he have come to write... that particular piece.
You know, I could speak about this, but Adam, would you? Come on. Do we flip a coin?
I think that one does get a sense from the books that he was part of a very self-conscious Jewish community, that he knew his ancestors and the language that they spoke, the dialect that they spoke, but that he didn't believe in God, and he wasn't practicing and observant. However, he probably knew the Bible. He probably had gone to synagogue enough to know some of the liturgy.
Yeah, I in knowing that bunch of Piemontese Jews in their development, you know, they were emancipated in 1848. They came out of the ghettos. They very quickly joined society. Until then, they were not allowed to go to university. They weren't allowed to join into liberal professions or anything like that. They jumped into society. They had a very pivotal role in the shaping of the unification of Italy. They were deeply secular in their lives, and there was always a portion of them that wasn't and that kept traditions alive and kept them on. And I mean, I know what they wrote in the previous, you know, 150 years, and they constantly lamented how much tradition was being lost and at the same time how much modernity was important. And so both identities kind of coexisted. So personally, I don't see any contradiction in that.
He practices all three. There is no better strategist than Henri in manipulating, cultivating, he says, the English prisoners of war. In his hands, they become real geese with golden eggs. If you remember that in exchange for a single English cigarette, you can get enough in the lager not to starve for a day. Henri was once seen in the act of eating a real hard-boiled egg. Trading in products of English origin is Henri's monopoly. And this is all a matter of organization. But his instrument of penetration with the English and with others is compassion. Henri has the delicate and subtly androgynous body and face of Sodoma's Saint Sebastian. His eyes are dark and profound. He has no beard yet. He moves with a natural, languid elegance, although when necessary, he can run and jump like a cat. Henri is perfectly aware of his natural gifts and exploits them with the cool competence of someone handling a scientific instrument. The results are surprising. Basically, it's a question of discovery. Henri has discovered that compassion, being a primary and instinctive sentiment, flourishes if skillfully inculcated, particularly in the primitive minds of the brutes who command us. Those very brutes who have no scruples about knocking us down for no reason and trampling us once we're on the ground. Nor has the great practical importance of the discovery escaped him. And on it, he has built up his personal industry. Henri sizes up the subject, son type, at a glance. He speaks to him briefly in the appropriate language, and the type is conquered. He listens with increasing sympathy. He is moved by the fate of this unfortunate young man, and it isn't long before he begins to yield results. There is no heart so hardened that Henri cannot breach it if he sets himself to it seriously. In the lager and in Buna as well, his protectors are extremely numerous. English soldiers, French, Ukrainian, Polish civilian workers, German politicals, a cook, even an SS officer. It's natural that Henri, possessing such notable friendships, is rarely reduced to the third method, theft. On the other hand, of course, it's not a subject that he willingly discusses. It's very pleasant to talk to Henri in moments of rest. It's also useful. There is nothing in the camp that he does not know and about which he has not reasoned in his close, coherent manner. Of his conquests, he speaks with modest, polite modesty, and as a prey of little value, but he digresses willingly to explain the calculation that led him to approach Hans by asking him about his son at the front, or Otto, by showing him the scars on his shins. To speak with Henri is useful and pleasant. Sometimes one feels a warmth and closeness. Communication, even affection, seems possible. One seems to glimpse the sorrowful, conscious, human depth of his uncommon personality. But the next moment, his sad smile freezes into a cold grimace that appears practiced at the mirror. Henri politely excuses himself. J'ai quelque chose à faire. J'ai quelqu'un à voir. And here he is again, intent on his hunt and his struggle, hard and distant, enclosed in armor, the enemy of all, inhumanly sly and incomprehensible, like the serpent in Genesis. After my talks with Henri, even the most cordial, I always had a slight taste of defeat and a confused suspicion of having been, in some inadvertent way, not a man to him, but an instrument in his hands. I know that Henri is alive. I would give much to know his life as a free man. But I do not want to see him again.
Okay. I hope you can hear us. Yes, wonderful. My name is Francesco Spagnolo. It's really my honor to moderate tonight's panel. We have some time to talk about the works of Primo Levi and their translation into English. And I brought to our panelists a little present. It's not very precious. It's a printout from, you know, from the internet. But you have it too, if you were able to grab one. It's a list. And it's a list that the great Italian writer Italo Calvino, whose collected works have yet to appear in English, correct? Yes. Wrote, and they're part of their the plot around his six memos for the next millennium, which he prepared. These were lectures, these were Norton lectures that he was invited to present at Harvard in 1985. He didn't complete them, and he died that same year. But if you go through the list, you'll see that the list includes lightness, quickness, exactitude, visibility, multiplicity, and consistency. He wrote this in English. He prepared the lectures in English, so we don't need to translate these into Italian for the time being. When I thought about speaking with you tonight, these six categories or literary values immediately came to mind, because it is my feeling that they can all be applied to Primo Levi. And that's not true of every writer, right? I'm sure we can think of many writers to whom at least some, if not all of these categories don't really apply. And echoing also the opening words of the Consul General of Italy, Mauro Battocchi, about the fact that Primo Levi has really inspired a whole generation of Italians since the 60s, you know, I remember growing up, I remember exactly where Se questo è un uomo, if this is a man, the single volume in the Einaudi edition was in the library, was among the books that I was not supposed to read. I was supposed to read after a certain age, but not quite yet. And then, of course, it was one of the books that I did read. And it was phenomenal because my, you know, all of my family experiences were somewhat there, but they were also in my own language. And usually my relatives told them in different languages, not in my native Italian. So it was, for me, a coming home, even though it was a very unsettling home. In any case, the reason why that book was there is also, and then it became my own book, because in 1976, an edition of This Is a Man became essentially mandatory reading in public schools in Italy. And the issue there is not just that of, as we would call today, Holocaust education. But that book has helped shaping the way in which Italians read and use the Italian language since. So what happened through that motion, through that passage of Primo Levi from the list of forbidden books for children to the list of mandatory books for young people in Italy, was that a classic came into being. And in a way, these six categories, these six qualities, values, literary values that Calvino lists, are the stuff of a classic. So I think I have a couple of suggestions for you tonight, if you want to take up the challenge. One is to maybe pick one or two of these and see how they resonate with you, with your reading of Primo Levi, and then to take the conversation from there, thinking about how the translation of the complete works of Levi into English may foster a conversation about the fact that maybe this is the work of a classic who's not just a classic in the Italian language, but maybe also in other languages, and how does that work? How do we move forward? And to sort of wrap up my initial question, which is not a question, it's more of a request, right? I also wanted to note that although many of the readings that the wonderful and poignant reading that preceded us, and also a lot of the public conversations around Levi begin with his memoirs and with If This Is a Man, If It's a Questo Uomo. The 18 chapters of This Is a Man are about 200 pages. You probably know exactly the number of pages then, but 200 pages out of 3,000. So we have a chance here to really think more broadly and to think and have a conversation in English about this. So this is sort of our mandate for the night. But if you wanted to I don't know, maybe select if you want to take up this challenge and select one or two of these literary values and see how they apply to your own reading and translating in your case and of Primo Levi, would you like to start?
I would immediately leapt to exactitude, particularly as a translator, I think. I mean, Levi's language is so exact. I mean, he was a scientist, and he used all the skills of a scientist, the particular skills of a scientist, in his writing. His descriptions are very specific. They're very particular and concrete. And not only in his writing about Auschwitz, which was really, I think, astonishing in that way, where he talked about what people did, what the day was like, what the night was like, but in his other writing as well, in the periodic table, his memoir, based on the elements of the periodic table, well, not based on exactly, but each chapter, you probably know this, takes off from an element of the periodic table. Many of them are actually about the element, some of them are less so, but he talks about scientific processes, scientific operations, mechanical processes, and in a very particular way, not so easy for the translator all the time, but it's very amazing. And I'll just say one more thing about exactitude. In his other writing also, he wrote a lot of science fiction. It's not really science fiction, but sort of science fiction type stories, just to spread out over those 3,000 pages. He was also very exact. I mean, these are usually quite short stories, but each one creates a kind of little world that is very particular, very specific, and very vivid, really. So that's exactitude.
Yeah, I think just to talk about the range a little bit, about what's in these three volumes, I think when we think of Levi, we think usually of the book If This Is a Man, which was originally translated in English as Survival in Auschwitz, and in this edition, the original Italian title has been restored, and maybe also The Periodic Table, his memoir, and The Drowned and the Saved, which is the book that he wrote many years later, looking back on his Auschwitz experience. But there are also many other books and essays and short stories included in this edition. He wrote a second memoir called The Truce about his return home from Auschwitz. He wrote a novel about a Jewish partisan band during World War II based on extensive research. And then he wrote these sort of whimsical, almost short stories. There's a series of short stories, for example, about a salesman for an American company named Simpson, I think, who sells a series of ever more outlandish inventions, one of which is a copier that can copy things in three dimensions, sort of like a 3D printer. And it's interesting to read these stories to see how these inventions have come true in a certain way. But then someone gets a hold of it and realizes, well, what if we started copying people? Or what if we started copying diamonds? We could be incredibly rich. There are little sort of scientific parables like that about technology and the dangers of technology. But I think that there is, for me at least, there's at least some resistance in thinking about Levi as a literary writer, because even though he was obviously a literary writer, what he's writing about is also testimony. What he's writing about is his own experiences in Auschwitz and what they meant. And we don't read that in the same way as we read a regular book, an ordinary book. And Levi is in a sort of category with a very few other writers. I think of him as being in a category with writers like Solzhenitsyn or Elie Wiesel, obviously, or even someone like George Orwell, who went through the worst parts of the 20th century and stood for certain values, stood for certain humanistic values. And so for me, all of these qualities in his writing, which are definitely there, are expressions of this determination to bear witness accurately, but also to maintain some sort of honor as a human being after going through these desperate experiences. So there's a moral quality to these literary qualities.
So definitely having a conversation about Levi that is not also a conversation about history, that one, you know, with the capital H, rather than about his writings, it's always problematic, right? So much so that when Levi himself debuted as a straight, it's San Francisco, we can use this word, a straight writer with a collection of fiction, the short story published in 1966, A Storie Naturali, Natural Histories, he did so under a pseudonym. The pseudonym was Damiano Malabaila. And there is some discussion about whether this was a request of the publisher. The publisher didn't want him to put out a book that was a book of fiction and not a memoir with his, in his own name. But we do know that he picked the pseudonym. And it's a very emblematic pseudonym. The last name, Malabaglia, essentially means evil nurse.
Wasn't it also the name of a plumber?
It was, but he argued that he just caught the name out of a sign of a plumbing supply store in Turin, which is entirely possible. However, I'm sure there were many other signs in Turin that he could have picked, and not this one. By the way, today I checked if you look, there is a Damiano Malabaglia profile on Facebook, and there is a Damiano Malabaglia handle on Twitter. That tweets about Primo Levi. So the pseudonym has a life of its own, clearly. But aside from picking this pseudonym and either being politely asked by the publisher or choosing to have it and to have this one, he does, in describing his work as a fiction writer, say that these are divertissements. That it's not almost like something not to be taken too seriously. And yet, at the same time, even in the most extreme of fiction and science fiction, I'm thinking, for example, of the... it's a short story, it's really a play Sleeping Beauty in the Fridge, mm-hmm. Where this lady has lived, young woman has lived for a long, long time frozen and wakes up. He's woken up... only a few minutes or hours every so often, and then turns out to having been abused by her custodians. So there's always an undertone there
that's true.
Right? We're always torn between giving full literary credentials and mm-hmm. then history coming back through the window and mm-hmm. and really pushing us into a corner in a way.
I think isn't it also true that he wrote a kind of, I don't know if it was exactly an introduction, but not an introduction to that first book, Natural Histories, or his second book, I guess. But he also, it was clear, although it was written under pseudonym, it was clear that he was the author. Isn't there that thing that was either on the cover or they ran a kind of band across the book, mm-hmm. where he says the author of this is known for these, for writing a memoir, but he's also the author of this. So it was, even though it was a pseudonym, people knew who it was. Yeah.
It was no Elena Ferrante. There
was not, right, it was not, no Elena Ferrante, yeah. So it was, but it's certainly true that there is that tension, I guess, between history and literary work. I guess he felt that himself. I mean, I think he was eager to be seen as a literary writer, a literary person, a writer, and he talks a lot about that. I mean, he struggled a lot with it because when he finally quit his job as a chemist and sort of became a writer full time, he talked about it a lot. I mean, he was nervous about it, I think. But anyway, there is that tension.
And some of those science fiction stories are also very serious sort of parables. There's one, I think the title story in the book, Flaw of Form, which is about a soul in heaven, and the soul is being offered the chance to be incarnated, to be born on Earth, and the people telling him what life is like on Earth are basically giving him a sort of hard sell and only focusing on the good parts. And then gradually, as the story goes on, he begins to see there's also war, there's aging, there's sickness and death, racism. And in the end, this soul says, I'm willing to be born on Earth, but only if I'm willing, only if I can go through the worst that people go through. I don't want any special treatment or any special privileges. I want to have to suffer with the people who are suffering. So it starts out as a sort of a science fiction story, but it ends up being a story about on what conditions is life worth living. So he does manage to connect both sides of his writing.
And yet, and on the other hand, as I was trying to suggest, his writing, the quality of his Italian is that of what becomes a form of canonical Italian as shaped literary language and public language in Italy since it appeared and since it entered the public arena. So there is a literary quality there that is somewhat independent of the content, of the historical content of the memoir, and that stays, that remains to this day, that is still perceivable. In that sense, I think that Calvino's qualities are very much at play here, and what essentially what happens is that possibly, and this is really a question for the translator too, the echoes of high literature, both Italian and world literature, in his writing, the exact writings of a scientist, are very much present. There are echoes that are part of his upbringing. Primo Levi went to the classical, liceo classico, the classical high school in Torino, Liceo d'Azeglio, where he not only was exposed during the years of fascism to an anti-fascist environment, but also acquired the intellectual tools that opened up, and this is the old educational system of Italy, opened up all of the classics of you know, Latin and Greek and of course high Italian literature. So it's no surprise that he's able to quote Dante by memory even in Auschwitz, right? Because it's part of his intellectual DNA. Now the question is, how does this very complex literary world work in the work of the translator? Is it, you know, it, to an Italian reader, it is both Dante, but it's also the Dante that is learned in school that passes through the pages. So I'm wondering what kind of considerations are there? And again, my question here is, what happens to this? Like, what happens to these qualities that are there in its English, the lingua franca of the 21st century, incarnation?
Just on a practical level.
Just to put a little bit of responsibility on you, make sure that, you know, have enough.
In my usual fashion, I'll answer on a concrete level. I mean, there's the question of references, particularly in Levi, literary references, particularly Dante. Manzoni is another one, where Italian readers get the references and English readers don't get it. I mean, in the Canto of Ulysses, which is the famous chapter of This Is a Man, where he tries to remember this, the canto about Ulysses and Dante in the Inferno. That's clear that he's talking about Dante in a very overt way, but there are many other places where there's a quotation from Dante that an Italian reader will recognize. It doesn't have to be pointed out. So the question is, the practical question is, are you going to point it out or not? Are you going to just let it go by? Are you going to have a footnote or what? So, you know, there's kind of a balance of footnotes and not footnotes. And but there's no way to, I don't think there's any way to make the Dante references or any of the literary references classical to an American or Anglophone reader. I mean, I think that there's been work done. Levi apparently in the first version of, or in earlier versions of If This Is a Man, he had many more literary references, many more overt literary references, which he eventually removed, I think. I think there's a book that's been done about this, that's Alberto Cavaglione. I think in that book he talks about all this. So I think it's there. You can study it, but I think you just have to take it on faith. You, the English reader. So I don't know if that's a good solution. Do you have a better one?
No, of course not. That's why I'm just moderating this. Otherwise, I, of course. Adam, what do you think of this idea of a classic? Do you think it holds beyond the Italian context?
Well, it's interesting to think of a book like If This Is a Man as a classic, in part because it is a book that so many people read as young people in school. I think that's true here, too. It's a book that is often the book that young people learn about the Holocaust by reading what Auschwitz was from a book like this, or Night. Those are the two, I think, books that are most often assigned. And in, I think there's an afterword to If This Is a Man, in which he talks about, Levi talks about his experiences dealing with students. He says, I would often be invited to go to schools and in Italy and also in Germany, I think, and talk to students about what he had written. And he talks about some of the questions that he got. And the questions were things like, on the one hand, why didn't you fight back? Why didn't you resist? And on the other hand, do you forgive? And he describes how there was a strong pressure, especially in a Catholic country, for the Jew to be seen forgiving. That if you were overcoming your anger, you were embracing the sort of Christian value of forgiveness. And he fights back against that. He says, I forgive people who ask for forgiveness. But if someone doesn't ask for forgiveness, then they're still my enemy. And I don't forgive someone who's my enemy. And there's a sort of amazing story, I think it's in the periodic table, where he talks about corresponding with a man who he knew in Auschwitz, named Müller, I think, who was one of the German scientists who was in charge of the chemistry lab where he was working as a prisoner. And then 15 years later, Levi, who was a chemist in a paint factory, ended up having a business correspondence with this man, and he realized that it was the man who had been his superior officer in Auschwitz. And he talks about the correspondence that they had and how this German wanted his forgiveness. He wanted to prove that he had done things right, that he had tried to help, and that was his memory of what had happened in Auschwitz. And Levi refuses to allow him to get away with this. He says, no, in fact, you didn't try to help. There were people who did risk things to help, but you weren't one of them. And the man desperately wants to meet with him in order to have it out. And then just before they can meet, he dies. Müller dies. And so it's this unreconciled relationship. And so I think that he was very conscious of being an educator, that he was explaining what this historical event was for people who weren't going to know it themselves. And he was conscious of that responsibility. And I think that he really did an amazing job of that, which is one reason why people love him and honor him, because when you read his books, you come to grips not only with, as people have said, what a day in Auschwitz was like, in a way that I don't know if any other book tells you that, but also, especially in his later work, what it means and what are the lessons that you can draw from it.
In this, and he describes himself as a centaur, an animal that is two at once, right? And that is both in terms of his scientific and literary minds, of his being a witness and being a writer. And he's also, and I remember this just by virtue of growing up in Italy when he was alive, and he was a public intellectual. He was on television very often and interviewed on all kinds of topics. He felt always, at the same time, very approachable. His role, as you were mentioning, going into public schools and speaking with students. And at the same time, also very distant, very removed. And I wanted to ask both of you if you think that this is something that is perceivable through his writings and how you negotiate through this duality.
First things first, I'd like to thank Andrew Monikos as a patron of Arts and Ideas. Yeah. When Anne met with our programming team to first talk about possibilities for her first named lecture here at the JCC, we came up with many ideas, but as soon as she heard about the complete works, that was it. She was set. So thanks to her generosity, we were able to assemble truly an all-star lineup of guests whose bios you can read in your handout program, but I'm so excited to be here tonight, and I hope you are too. This is really a wonderful, wonderful program lineup. Here this evening to get the program off the ground is Mauro Battocchi, the Consul General to Italy in San Francisco. Mauro.
So, dear Stephanie, ladies and gentlemen, it is a real privilege for me to attend this event on Primo Levi. My heartfelt thanks to JCC for taking the initiative. It honors me to see Levi recognized today in San Francisco by so many distinguished speakers, because I venture to say that by now, Primo Levi has become one of the most respected and beloved writers in Italian literature. I have to say that his words marked my intellectual and emotional coming of age. Mine, but as well as that of so many young Italians starting from the 60s. His words resonate in my mind indelibly. You who live safe in your warm houses, you who find returning in the evening hot food and friendly faces, consider if this is a man, se questo è un uomo, who works in the mud, who does not know peace, who fights for a scrap of bread, who dies because of a yes or a no. And yet, when Levi went back from Auschwitz to Torino and presented his manuscript of This Is a Man to the Einaudi publisher, he was turned down. It took several years before his message broke through a wall of rejection and disbelief, or simply discomfort. The first years after his return back home, he had a hard time to make himself heard. Yes, it was disbelief and discomfort, for it was very hard for Italians to come to terms with the sheer tragedy of what Italy's fascist regime had contributed creating. At the end of September, here in San Francisco, we had a great event at the Castro Theater with a movie directed by Vittorio De Sica, The Garden of the Finzi Continis, after a novel by Giorgio Bassani. The movie shows the story of a Jewish-Italian family until the moment of their deportation. And if you saw the movie, I mean, you can remember, they leave their beautiful mansion in Ferrara in disbelief. They can't believe what their compatriots are doing to them, forcing them out of their homes. Primo Levi takes a step further and shows the next step of their victim, of the victims of deportation into horror and hell. So I believe that today, Italians are very thankful to Levi for giving us his accurate, detailed, neutral report of the path of degradation that he had to go through. He reminds us that at every time, every nation, including our own, has to be vigilant. Our respect for other human beings cannot be taken for granted, unfortunately, especially if we label those human beings with dehumanizing tags. And we have, as you know, many of them. So let me say thanks, grazie, to JCC, and I would say grazie to Primo Levi for his extraordinary testimony. Enjoy the program. Grazie.
Thank you. I'm going to read two poems. One of them is by Primo Levi. One is by Constantine Cavafy, the modern Greek poet. And the reason I'm doing this is because when I found the poem that I'll be reading of Primo Levi's called A Profession, I couldn't stop thinking of a poem called The First Step by Cavafy. And they speak to each other. And I've been thinking, even just out in the green room, as to whether I should read them both. But I'm going to, because they're one somehow for me. All right. And this one is called The First Step. And it was written sometime early last century in Alexandria. All right. The young poet Evmenis complained one day to Theocritus. I've been writing for 2 years now, and I have composed just one idyl.
It's my only completed work. I see, sadly, that the ladder of poetry is tall, extremely tall. And from this first step I now stand on, I will never climb any higher. Theocritus replied, words like that are improper, blasphemous. Just to be on the first step should make you happy and proud. To have come this far is no small achievement. What you have done is a glorious thing. Even this first step is a long way above the ordinary world. To stand on this step, you must be in your own right a member of the city of ideas. And it is a hard, unusual thing to be enrolled as a citizen of that city. Its councils are full of legislators no charlatan can fool. To have come this far is no small achievement. What you have done already is a glorious thing. And this was written or published January 2nd, 1984. A profession. All you have to do is wait, your ballpoint poised. The lines will buzz round you like drunk moths. One comes near the flame, you grab it. No, it's not over, one is not enough. But it's a lot already, the work started. The others compete to land nearby, lined up or in a circle, ordered or disordered. Simple and silent, obedient to your command. You are the boss, without a doubt. If it's a good day, you order them in droves. Fine work, no? It's time-honored, 60 centuries old and ever new, with strict rules or relaxed ones or no rules, as you like. You sense you're in good company, not lazy, not lost, not always useless, sandaled and togaed, cloaked in linen, crowned with laurel. Just be careful that you don't presume. Thank you.
Two more poems. Primo Levi wrote poems throughout his life. These are early poems in which he tries to get at that experience, the experience that he calls of those ferocious nights. So these poems, I picked two of them from a gorgeous book, the Forrest Strauss Anthology of 20th Century Italian Poetry. It's the place where Primo Levi's great prose writer takes his place among the astonishing Italian poets who survived that destructive wreckage of the 40s, Senzotto and Montali and Campagna, Saba. The first poem has, I picked these two because one of them just tries to get, must be just trying to re-experience what it was like to be there. And the second one is one in which he wrestles with the meaning. And Goldstein, maybe should read the first one. I should say a word about the first poem. It has a Polish word in it. And the word is wstać, and it means get up. But in Polish, it would pronounce slightly differently. It would have a religious context of arise, a resurrection.
Alzarsi. Sognavamo nelle notti feroci, sogni densi e violenti, sognati con anima e corpo, tornare, mangiare, raccontare, finché suonava breve e sommesso il comando dell'alba, stach. E si spezzava in petto il cuore. Ora abbiamo ritrovato la casa, il nostro ventre è sazio. Abbiamo finito di raccontare, è tempo. Presto udremo ancora il comando straniero, Vstach.
Italian language is so beautiful. Everything sounds amazing in it. So it's reveille in English. In the brutal nights, we dream dense, violent dreams, dreamed with soul and body, to return, to eat, to tell the story, until the dawn command sounded brief and low, vestach. And the heart cracked in the breast. Now we have found our homes again. Our bellies are full. We finished telling the story. It's time. Soon we'll hear again that strange command, vestach. The second poem, and in Italian, Shema.
Shema. Voi che vivete sicuri nelle vostre tiepide case, voi che trovate tornando a sera il cibo caldo e visi amici, considerate se questo è un uomo che lavora nel fango, che non conosce pace, che lotta per mezzo pane, che muore per un sì o per un no. Considerate se questa è una donna, senza capelli, senza nome, senza più forza di ricordare, vuoti gli occhi e freddo il grembo, come una rana d'inverno. Meditate che questo è stato. Vi comando queste parole. Scolpitele nel vostro cuore, stando in casa, andando per via, coricandovi, alzandovi. Ripetetele ai vostri figli. O vi si sfaccia la casa, la malattia vi impedisca. I vostri nati torcano il viso da voi.
The thing I love about poetry is that 60, 70 years after that poem was written, you're hearing his voice, his breath, his vowels, his breathing. Shema. You who live safe in your warm houses, you who come home at evening to find hot food and friendly faces, consider if this is a man who toils in the mud, who knows no peace, who fights for a chunk of bread, who dies at a yes or a no. Consider if this is a woman without hair and without name, without strength to remember, empty eyes and cold womb like a frog in winter. Be mindful that this has been. I urge these words on you. Carve them on your heart. At home or roaming the streets, lying down or rising up, repeat them to your children, or may your houses fall. Sickness lay you low. Your offspring turn their faces from your eyes. Primo Levi.
I want to read a short prose portrait of Henri, a young man who appears in, if this is a man, Primo Levi's masterwork about the evil at the camps, the destruction of the best, the destruction even of those who thought they survived. I've edited these paragraphs to fit into this small space of time. Henri. Henri is eminently civilized and sane and possesses a complete and organic theory on ways to survive in the lager. He's only 22. He's extremely intelligent, speaks French, German, English, and Russian, has an excellent scientific and classical education. His brother died in Buna last winter, and from that day, Henri cut off every tie of affection. He closed himself up in himself as if in armor and fights to live without destruction, using all the resources that he can derive from his quick intellect and his refined upbringing. According to Henri's theory, there are three methods by means of which a man can escape extermination and still remain worthy of the name man. Organization, compassion, and theft.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's fair.
I mean, you get very intimate with a writer when you're translating them. I don't know that that's exactly, if you're really intimate with the person, if you don't know the person, but you do definitely have a sense of a person. And I don't, there is a kind of often a kind of ironic tone which in Levi, which is kind of, sort of distancing. But it's also, there's also very, a kind of warmth that isn't obvious, I think, and a kind of emotion that isn't necessarily obvious when you first read him. So I guess I feel that I mean, it's hard to know because I wasn't a student in a school, unfortunately, where Levi, but it was very important to him, to talk to students and to tell his story. I mean, that's really what was...
I guess I was also inspired by the two photos that were chosen for this. And this is not going to go well over the radio waves, but there is a photo on the side of the three volumes. And I was sitting in the audience earlier and felt that Primo Levi was really looking at all of us with a very critical gaze. And then the back of the box of the three volumes has a much more welcoming tone. It's a photograph. It's also a portrait of his. And it's a way more welcoming one. Adam, how do you feel about the duality, both self-described and perhaps perceived, of Primo Levi?
Well, it's true that someone who writes about himself extensively in certain parts of his life, in certain ways, and then in other parts he doesn't tell you anything at all. So he's not really a confessional kind of writer. He's not someone who wants to tell you everything about his life. I don't think he writes at all about his marriage, for example. There's one particular episode in which he says that he's not going to tell you about it, which is when he was fighting with a partisan unit. The reason that he ended up in Auschwitz was not simply a house-to-house search, the way some people were deported to Auschwitz, but that he was caught fighting in a partisan band against the German occupiers in Italy after Mussolini had been deposed. And he says, I don't want to talk about this episode. And it obviously pains him. There's obviously something going on in that experience that he doesn't want you to know about. And then in one point when he talks about it, I think this is also in the periodic table, he says that while he was a partisan, he and his fellow partisans executed one of their members. And he doesn't tell you exactly why, but he says that they felt that it was necessary. And he's obviously very ashamed and very... torn up about this experience still. He doesn't want to talk about it. So there are limits. There are limits to what he's going to reveal. I think that he is very outward turning as a writer. He's very focused on the external world, the way things work. He's very especially interested in the way things work, both on the level of chemistry and the level of psychology and institutions. But he's not the kind of writer who you feel is letting you in and becoming your friend in a certain way. So there is a sort of distance.
And would you like to tell us a bit about the making of this project? It was a 10-year, actually, earlier, before we came, yeah. I said 10, you said 11. But who was counting, right? 11 years of work, and also negotiating with multiple translations of some of the works and no translation at all for others. How did it all...
It was the vision of an editor called Robert Weil at Norton, the publisher Norton, and he decided he wanted to publish the complete works of Primo Levi. He had always loved Levi since he was a child, I think. But so it took him. The English rights were scattered all over the place. It took him 5 years to get together the English rights to Levi's work, and then he needed someone who spoke Italian to sort of be the editor of it. And that's where I came in, which was in 2004. and we realized, once we started looking at the translations that were available, that the original idea was just to put together the existing translations. It turned out that the translations were very ununiform, not only in style and in who the translators were, in when they were translated, but many of Levi's short pieces, his essays and stories hadn't been published in English in the way they were published in Italian. And so we decided to make the bold move of translating everything again. The one exception was If This Is a Man, which we could never get the English rights to. But then it turned out the original translator was still alive and had always wanted to redo his translation. So that was a lucky break. So we could advertise it as all new translations. But so there were, I think there are 9 translators. I translated 3 of the books myself, and then several of the other translators translated 2 each. But there was a long haul, because the books, you know, people worked at different speeds. They had to be edited. The idea was to make it to as great an extent as possible a uniform voice, because it's one writer. I mean, it's writing in different types of writing, but nevertheless the same person. So I guess that's how it all happened. And there were moments, as I was saying earlier, that when we weren't sure it was ever going to happen. But then at a certain point we realized, wait, we're only 2 translations are missing. We can do it. And we did eventually.
Can you share some other types of challenges, more on the intellectual or the translating part of it, like stumbling blocks or moments that you feel like were harder to resolve?
Well, I mean, one thing I did allude to was the question of references. You know, how are you going to deal with a lot of things that are that would be automatic, that would be known to the norm, to the general reader in Italian? Another thing was, well, you mentioned that the takeover of Italy by the of Northern Italy by the Germans, September 8th, 1943, is a date that every Italian knows, whereas I doubt whether any American knows the meaning of it. There are several references to that, and so, you know, do you make a footnote? I think Levi explains it in one place. So these kind of very detailed, I mean, that's one kind of challenge. The second challenge, which I think I also alluded to, is the science. I mean, there are a lot of descriptions that are quite beautiful of scientific processes. The last chapter of the periodic table is the history of a carbon atom, which is both very precisely scientific and also quite poetic. So that's a hard balance to strike, I think. So those are a few examples of the practical challenges, I think.
And Adam, would you like to share some challenges in reading Primo Levi for me?
Well, I read these books in English. I don't read Italian, so to me, this is Primo Levi for me. And I think it will be for millions of people in America and England and probably in other places as well. Well, one thing that I think reading Levi in this format brings home is that he had interests that were formed by his experience in Auschwitz, or maybe brought out by them, that he continued to develop and apply in other areas of life and other genres of writing. So for instance, there's a book of his called The Wrench. I think it was originally published as The Monkey Wrench. In this translation, it's called The Wrench. It's a very unusual book. It's basically a series of stories told by a fictional character named Faussone, right, who's a rigger. He rigs cranes and bridges. So he does dangerous, difficult, high-altitude construction work. And he's telling stories about the jobs that he's done and his experiences to a narrator who's very much like Primo Levi. And the two of them are together, I think, in Eastern Europe at a job site. And at night, they get together, and this man tells some stories. It's an unusual book because it has no plot, really. It's a series of anecdotes, more or less. And the anecdotes are all about things like, how do you build a bridge, or how do you build an oil rig in an ocean storm? But what the book is really about is work. And Levi is someone who values work very highly. For him, work, dignified work, meaningful work, is really the most important thing in life. It's the source of freedom. And it's fascinating because here's someone who was in Auschwitz, where on the gates it says, work makes you free. Arbeit macht frei. And that is what Levi believes. He believes that work makes you free. And I think that his experience in Auschwitz of work that was horribly distorted, work that was turned into a punishment and a curse and never amounted to anything, really reinforced in him the idea that work is important and is liberating and a good thing. There's a passage in one of, I don't remember where it is, when he talks about how opposed he is to the idea that work is a negative thing, that if we could only get free of it, we wouldn't have to do it, we could just let machines do it. And he says, no, work is one of the best things in human life. He was, one of his jobs was working in this chemistry laboratory where the job in the Buna camp in Auschwitz was to produce rubber, artificial rubber. And after years and all the lives lost and all the work that was done, no rubber was actually produced. So it was an example of completely wasted work, completely artificial work. And for Levi, I think that reinforced this idea that genuine work is important. For him, that work often took the form of chemistry. And this is something that relates in an interesting way to Levi as a Jewish writer, which is an identity that, as we were talking about earlier, he was ambivalent about. He did not necessarily want to be known as a Jewish writer, even though his experiences had so much to do with being Jewish. But in the periodic table, he says, one reason why he wanted to study chemistry is that he felt that his ancestors, the men in his Jewish community, had lost the use of their hands. They didn't know how to do anything with their hands. He says the women knew how to do things with their hands because they could cook, they could sew, but the men were all professionals, they're scholars or lawyers, and they didn't know how to build things or make things. And for him, chemistry was a way to regain that prowess, to be able to use your hands again. So even in that early of a stage, because he became a chemistry student, of course, before the war, before his camp experience, he was thinking about work and the meaning of work and work as a positive thing.
Thank you. Another important aspect of translating Primo Levi into English has to do with the history of the, especially the American, the North American reception of his works. There was one glitch, right? With If Not Now, When? This epic novel that Levi wrote detailing the history of a fictional group of Jewish East European freedom fighters, partisans, and their journey all the way to eventually across, after at the end of World War II, across the Brenner and into Italy, and then on their way to Palestine. And it was a book that many critics in Italy, in the US, perceived as not genuine. And it was sort of like, it had almost like a lesser status in his production. I'm suggesting to think about this relationship of reader and, you know, international readers and his work in connection with that phenomenal interview that Philip Roth did with Levi, in which there is a crucial, I mean, there are several crucial passages, but there is one that I at least stayed with me, has been staying with me for a long time, and has to do with the idea of the Jewish experience as an experience of uprootedness in Roth's sort of view. And Levi says, wait a second, except for the 10 months that I was in Birkenau, I've always lived here. I was born, that the family lore says that I was born on the exact spot where my desk is, where I write now. Right? So he claims mine is an experience of rootedness. And that's a very clear pattern in the Italian Jewish experience that doesn't really translate well into other types of, you know, I'm fond of calling Italian Jews as marginal cosmopolitans, right? And so it doesn't really translate into that broad context. If both of you can reflect on this topic, that would be great. Anne? Adam?
No. Adam. Oh, please, go ahead.
She's going to take a little time.
Well, I think that one reason why Levi speaks to American Jewish readers in particular is that his experience is very much like ours. When we read about the Holocaust in Eastern Europe, it seems like a different world. It seems like a different century almost. And even though that's where most of our ancestors came from, it's hard to imagine the way of life in a shtetl, in the Soviet Union, these places where most of the killing took place. Whereas when Levi describes his childhood as a completely assimilated, completely integrated, urban,